downloaded the Grease soundtrack earlier, so.
The Grease soundtrack
I have
from,
no
like, the original Grease soundtrack?
Grease Live.
Oh, okay. Like, I didn't know, like, the Olivia Newton-John one.
No.
Well.
I downloaded the brand new one.
It's not as embarrassing as the music that I opened up the WKRP episode of the podcast with, like, the very first podcast we've ever done.
Yeah, what was that stuff?
I think I was, like, doing, like, a little experimentation back then, and because WKRP, I think, took place in the 70s, like, the late 70s or
yeah.
the 80s, so I went on to, like, Google, and I just downloaded, like, news music from the 70s, and that came up, and I was like, oh, maybe we should just, like, every episode, we should just open up with, like, a dumb sound from whatever decade of the show that we're doing. And it was, like, this great idea that I had that one day, and then I was like...
And you didn't go through with it, like, at all.
And I just didn't go through with it at all. We didn't come back to it in other episodes.
Yeah.
Well, we did, like, a little crazy experimentation in the first couple. Like, I know, like, the Cosby episode,
yeah.
I think we played, like, episode clips, like, randomly, like, throughout the episode.
Yeah.
And I think, did we do that in WKRP, too?
Yeah, we did.
Well, I think, like, you were playing them from, like, your cell phone onto...
Yeah, we're playing them on from my cell phone into the laptop.
And then for our second episode, we did The Cosby Show, and I just tried to, like, randomly interject sound clips, but I could just never figure out where else to interject them in future episodes, so I just decided I'm never doing this again.
Yeah, it's a pain in the ass. And honestly, do we really need them? I don't think we do.
No, I don't think the audience really cares for them. I mean, if you do, tweet us. Oh, we might as well just start recording.
Yeah, are we, like, recording and stuff?
Hello.
Or are we just, like, gabbing?
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a very special podcast. This is the podcast where we watch all your favorite TV shows from yesteryear and then discuss them robustly over a glass of wine. And I probably will just include that banter because it seemed, like, important to the episode.
Yeah.
And speaking of experimentations, tonight I am recording. I don't know why I've always done this, but tonight I'm recording from a closet.
So you're in the closet.
Yes. So I emptied out the closet. I don't know why I've always done it in here because there's a carpet in here and it's comfortable and I feel like there won't be an echo.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess this is probably the last one I'll ever record in here, and this could be our best sounding episode. Who knows?
Who knows? I would go into my closet so that we could both be in the closet. However, my closet is freezing cold.
It's like an R. Kelly music video. Do you know, how come we've never done the R. Kelly music video as an episode of the podcast? Because there's like 40 installments of it.
Why did I drop my M&M?
Say that again?
I said, fuck, why did I drop my M&M? It just like flew out of my hand and landed on the ground.
For some reason, I thought you were talking about M&M the rapper. Anyway.
Oh god, this is gonna be a hot mess.
Anyway. I'm Patrick M. Dunn. You probably remember me from the previous 40 episodes of the podcast, because this is episode 41. I know that tonight. And I'm joined here, as always, by Kat Halstead, the author, and she...
Woohoo! You pronounced my name, like, perfectly correct.
Do I always say it wrong?
You exaggerate the Hall a little bit.
Halstead?
Yeah.
Well,
I got it right this time.
I think in the beginning I was saying it wrong, like in the first few.
Yeah.
And probably like 5 episodes ago too.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever we did, the burbs, that was probably, I probably said it wrong then. I'm not going back to listen to that because it's a 4-hour episode. I just don't have the patience to listen to
it. I don't even know. The burbs is a blur. We were both trashed.
And I apologize because there was like all these parts that I knew I wanted to edit out and I'm like... I listened to an hour of the episode, and this is it. I'm throwing it out into this universe. If you hate it, you can just shut it off. Anyway,
what studio? I have a question. What studio was the Burbs taped at? I don't remember off the top of my head.
It's like the Monsters Today studio, the cul-de-sac from...
Well, I know what Backlot. I know, was it, what studio? Was it Paramount, Warner Brothers? Is it a Warner Brothers studio?
I thought it was Paramount, but I may be wrong. I wasn't prepared. I didn't bring this info with me.
Well, I was just thinking about it because of the Grease Live filming on the WB lot.
Do I need to look it up?
No, you don't need to look it up.
I can look it up after. We'll do it after the show, and then we'll talk about it next week. So what is our website and our Twitter and our all that stuff? We can get that shit out of the way.
Okay. Our website is averyspecialpodcast.tumblr.com. Our Twitter is @verypodcast. And then, of course, you can follow Patrick at Twitter @PatrickMDunn or myself @CatDVS. And, yeah, that's the major stuff.
We have an Instagram.
We have an Instagram. A Very Special Podcast, right? What is it?
I think it's a very special podcast. I haven't done anything with there in a couple weeks, so maybe I'll get to it tonight. Who knows? Anyway, I wanted to start off. We frequently talk about Jared Leto on this podcast.
Yeah, Jared Leto. My obsession with him's kind of dwindling right now. I need some more from him.
Yeah,
right now I'm all about Chris Evans,
Captain America,
and Aaron Tveit.
Johnny Storm, is that his name? But so we've always talked about Jared Leto slyly on the side, and I realized that I never mentioned the story before, and it took 41 episodes to do so. So I've seen him before.
I'm so jealous, you don't even know.
All right, so it was probably, there was like a 3-4 year gap where he was just solely dedicated to 30 Seconds to Mars.
Yeah.
And he just didn't do movies around this time. And I believe, like, they got radio play, right? I believe.
Yeah, I think so.
I've never heard him on the radio, but I imagine they did because he has fans. Although, I don't...
Yeah, they have to have... Like, it's not the stuff on the kind of stations I would normally listen to. Like, I have I have one of their albums.
Like, College
Radio? It's a little weird. But...
Or, he might have been, like, an internet station, but... Anyway, so... There's a place in Boston, Harper's Ferry. It doesn't exist anymore, but it's a music hall. I believe it is now the Brighton Music Hall, but at one point in time, in like 2006 or 2007, whatever that like 3-year period where Jared Leto just decided to do music only, he and his band, 30 Seconds to Mars, they played at Harper's Ferry. They opened for someone. I don't remember who I saw them open for, but they definitely weren't like the headline. I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
But... It's the kind of music hall, it's a small venue, very small. You could have counted the number of people that were there.
Oh, wow, that's small.
That's how small it is. And the stage, like, it wasn't like with gates around it. It was just like a step, like a, you know how like usually like a band will come out from like a back door and they're already on stage?
Yeah.
They had to, like, come down a hallway where, like, pool tables were and, like, go onto the stage that way. So, like, if you were standing in the right spot, Jared Leto could have walked right by you.
Oh, my God.
But I believe I was lingering over at the bar. And I didn't expect to see him there. Like, I didn't even know... I don't think I even knew who 30 Seconds to Mars were or was. Are they still playing?
They're still together, yeah. They're still doing stuff.
So I didn't know, like... He was in it. I didn't know anything about it. And I was like, holy shit, it's Jared Leto. And I think one of my friends was like, yeah, he's like the singer for this band. And I was like, no, like, this is, like, you're joking, right? And they're like, no, he's, like, he sings in this band, 30 Seconds to Mars. And I'm like, oh, they're any good? And she was like, oh, I don't know, we'll find out. And then they started playing, and they would, like, finish a song, and then the crowd would boo.
Oh my gosh!
And, like, 3 or 4
fucking
songs...
Boston. Why are you guys so rude in Boston?
We hate everybody and everything. Like, it was so awkward that, like, the music would stop and you would hear, like, these guys suck. And they're like, fuck you, Jared. And It wasn't like a big enough place that the act wouldn't hear. Like you could like actually see who was saying that to you. And
oh god.
He never commented on anything. I think he just like said fuck off or something at one point. And then I believe he stopped in the middle of a song and just left. Like he just stopped and left. And it didn't end well. And he disappeared and he never came back out. And his band like played music for a little while, and then they just stopped. They got off the stage, and then like the opening act came up. Not the opening act. The headliner came up. The headliner came up, and I was like, I think I just saw Jared Leto like freak out.
Oh my gosh!
And I can't believe it's taken me that long to tell that story.
How have you never brought this up in all the times we've talked about Jared Leto?
You know, I don't know. I think I've, like, pushed it out of my memory. It was such a bad experience. Because, like, I've always, like, kind of... Like, he was Jordan Catalano. He was in some movies, like, through the years. He was in Fight Club. Panic Room. The Requiem for a Dream. And then he kind of, like, disappeared for a little while. So this is probably, like, prime 30 Seconds to Mars recording sessions.
Yeah, I guess.
But
probably.
Then, like, a year or two later, like, 30 Seconds to Mars came out with, like, a new album, and it was, like, a hit.
Yeah.
Maybe not a major hit, but, I mean, it's probably the album you have.
A hit for them.
It had, like, is there a song called Kings and Queens?
I have no idea.
It's probably the album that you have, but I saw them, like, before that album.
Let's see what... My iTunes says 30 seconds. I only have one album of theirs.
What's the name? What does it tell you? What year it came out?
2005. A Beautiful Lie.
All right, you probably have the one that I saw him perform. Then that was probably about right.
Yeah.
You know what? It probably was 2005. I probably like jumped ahead 2 years in the future.
You're all over the place, Marty McFly.
I am sorry. I apologize. Anyway, what are we watching tonight? Or what did we watch tonight?
Tonight, we are discussing the classic 1980s sitcom, CBS, starring the one, the only, Bob Newhart. We are talking about Newhart.
Not the Bob Newhart show, like the famous one, but just regular Newhart?
No, this is this other famous show.
This show ran from like 82 to 1990-ish, I believe, correct?
Yeah.
It was a CBS show.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't like a mega hit.
I don't know about that.
Well, I don't ever remember it being on live. I only remember from syndication. But then...
Oh, really? See, my family watched it live.
Okay. But I, like, looked up the show, and it did all right. Like, it was, like, in danger of cancellation for many years.
Really? But I didn't know that.
Like, the first season of the show, it's the basic premise. So, he plays Dick, a character named
Dick. Dick Loudon.
Dick Loudon, and he is an author, like a how-to. He writes how-to books.
Yeah, he writes, like, how-to books, like, how to build a bookshelf. And, like, travel books.
And he semi-retires?
Sort of. Like, he and his wife decide they want to own an inn.
And they move to Vermont, of all places.
Yeah, they move from New York City to Vermont.
And
the funny thing is about him writing these DIY books is he's not handy at all.
No, I kind of, like, did not get the impression ever. Like, ever, the whole time I've ever watched this show... It seems like he has no, like, gifts. Like, he's not gifted at all.
Yeah.
Like, he's not even funny in the show really that much. Like the supporting
cast. He's a straight man.
Like, the rest of the
cast. He's your every guy who moves to this wacky small town.
And it's kind of like, almost like Springfield, like from The Simpsons. The supporting characters are weird and wacky.
Yeah.
And he's just kind of like the normal straight man living in this world.
Mm-hmm. It's about how he reacts to them.
Yes. So the first season, I guess, primarily deals with him moving to Vermont. He is just settling in. He's still kind of like an author, but he's also running this inn with his wife.
Yeah.
And then, for some reason, they, like, retooled the show in its second season. They decided to make him, like, the television host of, like, a morning show.
It's like a weekly, like, Sunday afternoon talk show, vocal talk show to kind of, like, fill that weird time slot.
Yeah, it's like...
Where it's like you either put in some local programming or you put on reruns of Bosom Buddies.
Yeah, like, this town is weird because it has, like, everything in it. So, like, they have their own morning show. They have their own late night show. It's like a self-sufficient town.
Like, I've lived in small towns and we never had, like, our own TV shows.
Like, did you ever have, like, your own, like, The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson, like, in your own town?
No.
Like, I don't even know, like, what, do we know what town in Vermont this takes place in?
Crap.
Is it Waterbury for some reason? That...
I'm looking at my notes. I don't think I have that.
You're usually on top of that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like, if they ever mentioned the...
Give me a second. All right.
Heavy.
Newhart is an American television sitcom which aired on CBS from October 25th, 1982 to May 21st, 1990. It takes place in a small rural Vermont town. It's an unnamed town. Okay, most likely...
Okay, so I was like, why don't I have the name of the town?
It's most...
Okay, I feel way less crazy right now.
It's most likely Norwich, Vermont, they say. And they operate the 200-year-old Stratford Inn. Dick is a sane, mild-mannered everyman surrounded by a community of oddballs. In a town which exists in an illogical world run by rules that elude him.
Because it's one of those towns where they do those, like, wacky, weird festivals at weird times.
Yeah, it's kind of, like I said, it's kind of like a precursor to Springfield or Pawnee from Parks and Recreations, where the show just follows...
Or Stars Hollow on Gilmore Girls.
Yeah, or Twin Peaks.
It's just, that's actually any, like, small town these days on a TV show.
And it's just a strange, odd world. Like, you get characters like Larry, Daryl, and Daryl.
That's one of my absolute favorites. And they're not even in this episode.
No, they're not in this episode. I was kind of disappointed. Like, did they include those characters all the way to the show's end?
Yeah, they were there for most of the, like, a good chunk of time. They weren't originally meant to be in the entire series. But it's like one of those things, the audience just loves them.
Yeah.
How can you not love these three guys who come in and only one of them talks and says, "Hi, my name's Larry, this is my brother Daryl, and my other brother Daryl."
And I believe Bob Newhart said he brought them in as a joke, and the studio audience just, like,
went crazy. They went insane for them.
They went, like, insane for them. Like, they decided to bring those characters back before the episode even aired on television.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, "We have to bring these characters back." But, alright, so tonight's episode is a season 8, I believe? Or 7?
Mm-hmm.
We're, like, late in the run.
It's season 7, episode 14.
Okay, so it's not the final season.
No.
It's near the end. The show has probably peaked in its popularity. Like, it's not getting any better. So they probably had to kind of do some, like, last-ditch efforts to kind of, like, keep ratings going. So they decided to bring in Don Rickles.
Mm-hmm. And, who is Bob Newhart's real-life bestie.
And not only is Don Rickles in the episode, but also Ed McMahon.
Woo! You may have won the Publisher's Clearinghouse!
But neither of those two actors... play themselves. They play fictional versions of themselves, basically.
Yeah.
Don Rickles plays a man named Don Prince, who was previously the star of It's Always Moesha.
Yeah.
And I guess he played, like, a deli clerk, like, from in this fictional It's Always Moesha.
Yeah, I guess so.
And then
I was really confused by that. I was like, I don't understand.
They
what the heck is a Moisha?
It was his name, right?
I think so, yeah.
But Don Rickles, he played a fictionalized version of himself. So he basically was Don Rickles, but just given a fake name. They just didn't want to say it's Don Rickles in the show because people wouldn't believe that Dick knew Don Rickles, I guess, is the...
Or that Don Rickles would do a late night TV show in Vermont?
No. Although, I wouldn't put it past him.
True.
So, what is your history with Newhart? You said that your family used to always watch it?
Yeah, like, I remember when I was growing up, Newhart was one of those shows that my mom watched, my grandma and my grandpa watched. So, because of how old I was at the time, I was watching it. You know? It's like when you're a little kid, the TV is on, like, the grown-ups are watching, but you're playing. And eventually there's a point where you start watching the TV with your family.
Like, did you ever, like, were you ever engrossed in the storylines of the show? Like, were you ever really into it?
I just really, like, when I was little, I remember things. Like, I remember Stephanie and Michael being, like, these ridiculous snobs. Of course, remember Larry, Daryl, and Daryl. Yeah. And, like, there's definitely a point where I understood what was going on, but I never, like, got it. Like, I've gone back and I've rewatched it now that I'm older. I'm like, oh, my God, this show is hilarious.
Yeah.
I totally did not get this as a kid.
I believe I told you after we watched this, I was like, I think this is the my most favorite thing we've ever done on the podcast. But, like, my history with the show, like, there really isn't one, because I always thought this was, like, it had, like, a grown-up vibe to it.
Yeah.
It was nothing that I was ever really into when I was a child. I don't remember it being on first run.
Mm-hmm.
But I do remember it being on syndication, but it was, like, late-night syndication. Like, I think where I lived, it was on at, like, 11 or 11:30 at night.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like, I would maybe see it on like a Friday night because I wouldn't have school the next day. So I would stay up late. So
yeah.
I specifically remember it was on TV 38, which is like our local channel here. It's the channel that eventually became UPN.
Mm-hmm.
And so like at 11 o'clock at night, it was like MASH was on. And sometimes I would watch that because I really liked the opening theme song to MASH for some reason. Like it always reminded me of G.I. Joe.
Yeah, the suicide is painless.
Yeah, like, I always, like, thought that it was, like, an action-oriented show, because I really liked, like, things like The A-Team and Knight Rider, and
mm-hmm.
then the actual MASH show would start, and it would just be, like, people talking, like, inside tents. And
you know, I remember, like, when I was a kid, I would watch MASH all the time. All the time. Like, on syndication or whatever. And, like, before dinner or something.
But did you ever
And I go back now, and, like, I loved it as a kid. I don't think I understood what the heck was going on back then. But I watch it now, I'm like, why the heck did I like this as a child? I didn't understand it.
I was in the same boat as you. Like, I would watch full episodes. I think I was always waiting for something exciting to happen, just because the theme song just seemed really, like,
mm-hmm.
the opening theme, you did, like, the helicopter, mm-hmm. and it looked like war mm-hmm. was happening. But then nothing, like, it was just people in a tent talking, like, maybe, like, an injured person would come in.
And then you'd have, like, the one guy in a dress every once in a while.
Yeah. And then, so when MASH ended, then Newhart came on. And it just, it has, like, it had a real kind of, like, the theme song to Newhart's not that exciting, I'm not gonna lie.
No, it's not. I was thinking about that earlier when I was rewatching it.
It's not memorable, and even, like, it's just kind of, like, scenic shots. It's just, like, a boat going across
yes,
the lake.
Yes, you know where those shots are from?
New Hampshire?
They're outtakes from the movie On Golden Pond, starring Henry Fonda and Katharine Hepburn. And if, like, you could look, if you can get a clear image of the car, that's who's in the car that's driving.
Oh, really? I'm gonna have to go back and
yeah.
watch that, and then watch On Golden Pond and see if I can see similarities.
Mm-hmm.
So they were like, CBS was just too cheap to go and like shoot a new theme song, like
I guess, or just They're like, we have these extra, this extra footage. Let's just use that.
But
it's New Hampshire. Nobody will notice that's not Vermont, except everybody in Vermont noticed it was New Hampshire and not Vermont.
Was it like a scandal?
It's in my notes. Let me see. What does it say? Vermont residents complained that the opening scenes were New Hampshire, not Vermont. So enough people complained that this is like a well-known fact.
I could see there being kind of like a rivalry, like a real-life rivalry between New Hampshire residents and Vermont residents.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can just picture myself being like, there's no difference between New Hampshire and Vermont, and I can just picture someone from Vermont being like, I reckon to differ.
You're going to get your ass kicked with that Boston attitude of yours.
Yeah, like, there's no difference between those two places. They're both green. They're both, like, drive-through states. Like, you're on your way through to somewhere. Have you ever been to Vermont or New Hampshire?
You know, I have not, but I almost went to college in Vermont.
Okay, like, I've been to New Hampshire. I've, like, stayed at places, and I've, like, skied there. I've been there in the summer. I've, like, gone on canoes and shit. But...
Okay, so, like... On the East Coast, the furthest north I've gone is, like, New York City.
That's it? You've never even, like...
That's it.
Not even, like, Connecticut?
Nope.
Although, I think Connecticut is, like, technically east of New York, so...
Yeah, it is, but...
I've been in the state of Vermont, but I've never stopped anywhere. Like, I've highwayed through it to go to Canada. And maybe I stopped at, like, a gas station or... a convenience store because I had to pee or something. Oh, no, I went to a board... Not a board. It's a Barnes & Nobles, like, 2 years ago in Vermont.
That is so random.
Well, I was coming back from Canada, and I got off the highway, and I knew there would be a Starbucks there, because there's always a Starbucks inside of Barnes & Nobles.
Yeah.
And then I just was like, well, while I'm here, I might as well just walk through the store and see what they got. So that's like my Vermont experience. I mean, I hear it's a nice place. I mean, it looks kind of nice.
Yeah, it looks nice.
Like, the capital, like, I remember driving through their state capital, and, like, usually, like, it's like a city. Instead of, like, you drive by, like, windmills and shit.
Wow.
So that's Vermont for you.
Wow.
Like, I bet, like, because I was there Labor Day weekend-ish time, so it was really nice at that, because everything was green and luscious. But I bet you it's a bitch in the winter.
Yeah, I'm really glad I did not go to college in Vermont and that I went to college in Southwest Colorado instead.
Although you probably would have enjoyed it up there. I mean, because, like, if you're...
Yeah, maybe. We'll never know.
You're marooned on a college campus. It's not like you're venturing out. So, like, if it snows, you're just in a dorm getting drunk somewhere, right?
That's pretty much what I did in college anyway.
It's like there's no difference between being marooned at a college campus and getting drunk in Vermont or Southwest Colorado, wherever the hell you went.
Well, yeah, probably not. We didn't actually, when I was in college, we really didn't end up that many times where we were like snowed in or anything. We got lucky.
Did they, like, it just didn't snow, or they did a good job of, like, shoveling you out?
Like, well, no, like, if we just didn't, there were times, we just didn't get a lot of snow those 4.5 years I was in college.
It was just, like, a global warming
we got snow. There were, like, a couple times we had, like, a couple good storms, but, like, the biggest storms we would get would always happen while school was out of session.
Yeah,
so, like, during the winter break or spring break.
Yeah, because
then,
like,
you come back and everything's already cleared.
Yeah, I feel like the early January is like when you get like the worst snowstorms, but like you're not usually, school's not in session during that time.
Exactly.
And you like you come back like maybe like the 23rd or something, and like that's usually like at the tail end of it, unless you get that like random like February storm.
Yeah, like there were a couple times we got some big storms, but like. None of them were, like, super, super bad.
It didn't, like, amount enough.
Like, what they're getting now. Like, if what I'm seeing on Twitter these days, they're getting pounded with snow down there.
So, how far away are you from there now?
I'm on the other side of the state. I'm, like, 6 hours away.
Oh yeah. I forgot, like, you live in a state that's, like, enormous. Because I can drive across Massachusetts in, like, 2 hours.
But it takes more than a day to cross the whole state.
Ugh. And I just live in this tiny ass, like, little dinky state.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, should we get into the episode, or do we have any, like, do we leave any, basic information?
Oh, here's a fun little trivia bit.
Okay.
Before we get started. So the character of George is played by Tom Poston.
Yep.
And
dim-witted handyman.
I believe he was, like, a comedian along with Bob Newhart and Don Rickles, because he appeared on the Bob Newhart show a few times. But originally, Jerry Van Dyke, as in Dick Van Dyke's younger brother, was the first choice to play George. But his audition didn't go well.
Really?
Yeah. That's okay, because Barry Kemp, the creator, later used Jerry Van Dyke on Coach in the role of Luther.
Okay, and Tom Poston, he's also popped up in Home Improvement.
Mm-hmm.
Murphy Brown, That 70s Show, he was Kitty's father.
Mm-hmm.
And again, he was on Coach. And Grease Under Fire. Wow, he's like in a lot of... Oh, hold on. Here's his best role ever. He played the Capital City Goofball on The Simpsons.
He played the Capital City Goofball? Are you serious?
He voiced... So, George... from Newhart, voiced the Capital City Goofball.
I love when we find out these really random things.
Yes, and of course, I had to check to see if he was alive. Unfortunately, Tom is dead.
Oh.
He died in 07 at the age of 85. Take a guess.
But you know who's still alive? Do you know who's still alive? Bob Newhart and Don Rickles.
All right. I was thinking about this earlier today. I think Don Rickles is probably, and Newhart too, they're probably like the last living comedians of this, like the early television era.
Mm-hmm.
I watched, alright, so a couple, like maybe like a year ago, I watched, alright, you know those like celebrity roasts with Dean Martin that he did in like the 70s?
Yeah.
Alright, so there's one. Oh, I mean, you can watch any one, but there's like one of the Lucille Ball one is on YouTube. You can watch it. And they introduce all the roasties or the roasters, whatever you call them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure the only one that was still alive was Don Rickles.
Oh my gosh.
Because I went through it. I think I looked up all these people just to see if any of them were still around. And I was like, oh no, I think Ruth Buzzy is still alive. I remember her being on it.
Crazy. That is crazy.
Yeah. So, Don Rickles, as of this recording, anyway, is still alive. We don't know.
And so is Bob Newhart.
And Bob Newhart. They're still kicking. Don Rickles still, he still regularly does stand-up acts. Like, I believe he did a show, like a big show.
So does Bob Newhart.
They're both, like, they tour. They do shows. I think right after Joan Rivers died, Don Rickles did, like, a show in Las Vegas, and he had, like, high attendance because a lot of people, like, feared that he was going to die the next day because, like, all these, like, celebrities are dropping. So they just wanted to, like, see someone from that era one last time. And
whenever, like, Bob Newhart is announced to be, like, guest starring on The Big Bang Theory or something, I'm like, yes! Woohoo!
Oh, he has, like, a regular run. Like,
I had to explain to my ex-boyfriend why I was so excited that Bob Newhart was going to be on The Big Bang Theory, and I was like, oh my god. Why do you not know this shit? He's an idiot.
He's like a recurring character on there, right? He's like he comes on every now and then?
Yeah, he played a guy who was like a Mr. Wizard kind of Bill Nye sort of guy. Who did like one of those like TV show, Dr. Proton or something.
Dr. Proton, that's a good name.
Professor Proton, something like that. And he did like a children's science show that Sheldon and the other guys watched when they were kids. And they like tracked him down and hired him to like do a party for them. And then his character died and his character shows up in Sheldon's dreams every once in a while.
Could you imagine if we ever just tracked down like Bob Newhart in real life and...
We're throwing a party. Will you please come and be our entertainment?
Who's the actress from Charles in Charge and also played Cindy Brady on
Jennifer Runyon.
Could you imagine if we tracked down like Jennifer Runyon to be like part of our lives?
That would be insane.
Do you know what I was thinking today? We should try to find someone that is in a TV show but like not really famous anymore, just to be on our podcast. Like they can just call in.
Oh like, my god! Okay, you start thinking about people. We'll start making lists.
I already
people
have
can
a list.
Tweet us suggestions. Oh god, you already have a list, don't you?
The brother from Small Wonder. I think he would definitely come on. We could probably get
Jenna before or after you bribe him with an Applebee's gift card.
We probably could bribe him with an Applebee's gift card. And we could probably get Jenna Von Oy. I just feel like we could get her for some reason. I feel like she's like totally reachable. And I don't know. I bet you we can get, who's Seth Meyers' brother? From that
Josh Meyers?
Yeah, I bet you we could get him too. I feel like he's like easily accessible.
Okay, so if you are one of these people that Patrick has just listed, contact us at averyspecialpodcast@gmail.com, and we will have you on the podcast.
Or do you think we can get Julia Duffy?
She's pretty busy. She works like crazy.
What is she up to?
She's always popping up and stuff.
What is she doing now?
Oh, I don't even know, but I see her all the time. Like, she always pops up on stuff.
Speaking of somebody who always pops in on stuff and is in the show is Peter Scolari.
Yeah.
So I think this is like Peter Scolari's like biggest body of work, I'll probably have to say.
I feel like this is like the role he's second best known for.
Because like I know like Bosom Buddies, which is going to be a future episode of ours, it really was only like, a short-lived show. It only had like 30-something episodes.
Yeah.
And he was probably in like 100 or so episodes of Newhart, but I went through his like television filmography the other day, and it just goes on forever.
Yeah.
And he always just is in like one or two episodes of things.
Mm-hmm. That's how Julia Duffy is. She's like always in like one or two episodes of stuff. She's usually like either the snotty principal or the snotty neighbor. She's usually somebody snotty.
like a celebrity chef maybe.
Or something, like, shows up on an episode of Melissa and Joey as the snotty neighbor who's upset that they're doing construction on the house, or on another sitcom as the snotty principal who's upset that the daughter's knocked up or something.
All right, Julia Duffy, she was just on Scream Queens. She was on the Thanksgiving episode. She played Chad Radwell's mom.
Okay.
She showed up on an episode of Suburgatory. She was only in one episode. She's been in The League. She's been on Anger Management, Melissa and Joey, like you said. Wizards of Waverly Place, CSI
New York. Okay, that was a Disney show.
She's been on The Drew Carey Show, Reba. She's been she has multiple episodes of Reba. Sabrina,
yeah, she's a snotty principal on Reba.
Mrs. Hodge was her character's name. She was on an 23 episodes of Designing Women.
Mm-hmm.
So, I guess, go her.
Yeah.
But
When Newhart ended, that was right around the time of the whole Delta Burke drama at Designing Women. And Delta left. They brought on Julia Duffy as, like, their northern cousin who took over, like, Suzanne's share of the design firm or something.
Well, I'll have to do Designing Women just to go over the Delta.
We will, because Designing Women is one of the greatest sitcoms ever.
All right, so, but I think Peter Scolari has a much more impressive resume than Julia Duffy, because he's been in The Love Boat, numerous episodes, The New Twilight Zone. He's like a voice actor. He's been in like a lot of superhero shows like Batman.
Uh-huh.
Multiple Batman episodes, Duckman, that old cartoon, Pinky and the Brain, Hey
Oh
Arnold.
My god, Duckman? Wow.
Scooby-Doo.
That takes me back.
And, alright, He also plays probably his like he plays Lena Dunham's father on Girls.
Okay.
He's a recurring character. Like he's like a major character on that show. I didn't realize that, to be honest with you. Like I never connected the two.
I wouldn't know since I don't watch shows on HBO.
It isn't. I think we will someday have to venture into Girls because it is an interesting show. It's not like the greatest show, but I don't know where it will land in the television landscape in the long run. But we'll definitely have to venture into that world at some point in time. So should we get into tonight's episode? Because since we're like
let's actually get into this episode.
All right. So this episode is called "The Nice Man Cometh."
Yes.
And the basic premise is that Dick, we already established that he works at a television studio in Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
And his boss, he's like a new boss, right, to this Vermont studio?
Yeah, so this like guy comes and he's just recently purchased the TV station. He recently fired Michael, played by Peter Scolari. And I guess when he took over, he had, like, his talent signed contracts stating that they can be used on whatever program the station owner deems.
And this station owner hired Don Prince, a.k.a. Don Rickles, as the new Prince of Late Night. It was, like, Vermont Tonight, I believe was the name of the show?
Yes, Vermont Tonight starring Don Prince.
And so it was the first episode. He wants Dick to be on the show as a guest.
Yeah, because he's like, we need a guest, and you're the biggest name I've got. So yeah,
he just welcome him to the the WPIV. Was that like the name of their TV studio?
Yeah, it was something like that. WIPV or something.
He's like, welcome him to the WPIV family, and. So Don Rickles, Don Prince, he used to be the star of It's Always Moesha, some like weird show that only George has ever heard of.
Apparently, George just starts like singing the theme song.
And the theme song is really long.
It's Always Moesha.
If you stick around, I was watching the end credits. Mm-hmm. And in the end credits, they have like a writing credit for the author of the It's Always Moesha theme song. So, like, I had to look it up.
Oh, my God.
Let me see if I can find the lyrics online to the theme song.
It's always Moesha. Da-da-da-da. I don't think that's how it goes.
I can't find it. But it's about a Jewish deli clerk.
Mm-hmm.
And just whatever rhymes with any kind of Jewish deli meats, like any words.
Okay, then.
All right, so Don Prince, he invites Dick onto his show, and mm-hmm. he's kind of like a dick. He's kind of like an insult comic, basically what Don Rickles is.
Yeah, he's trying to like do his like opening monologue, and like the five people that are in the audience are just like staring at him like, dude, you're not funny. And so they bring Dick out, and Dick's just being Dick. He's just like, well, welcome to the channel, blah, blah, blah. And Don just starts, like, insulting Dick.
Like, right off the bat.
Yeah, just like, he just starts insulting him, implying that he's drinking alcohol.
There's
and the audience just starts loving it. They're flipping out there so much.
There's a part where, so I guess they have, like, mugs of water on the table.
Yeah, and like every talk show
has.
So, there's always like the mug with the water or the wine if you're Kathy Lee and Hoda.
But Don
takes... fourth hour of the Today Show.
Don takes the mug and he goes, why are there olives in here? And Dick's like, there's not olives in there. He's like, yeah, there's right here. And he like takes a sip and he pretends to spit it out like it's really booze.
Yeah.
And then... I guess, like, there's not really much of a B-plot in this episode for some reason.
There really isn't. Like, you have, like, little bits of, like, Stephanie being a to Michael because they've broken up and he doesn't have a job.
Yeah, but it's like a 10-second, like, interplay between the two.
Yeah, like, that was pretty much, like, how long it took me to say it is how much you actually saw of it.
And, because, I guarantee you, maybe, like, an episode before this, they probably, like, just broke up, and they're probably going to get back together, like, in the next episode, but they have to...
Yeah, it's probably, like, something, well, from the way, since I haven't watched the episodes, my assumption would be that it has to do with the station owner's daughter, who Michael called a slut, and that's what got him fired.
Yes, alright, so... Michael was originally Dick's boss, right?
Yeah, like, he was the producer of his show.
And then the station got bought out by this other guy.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael called the other guy's daughter a slut, or tramp or something. Mm-hmm. I forget, like, the word they used.
Yeah, something like that.
It's CBS in the 80s. They didn't say slut.
Are you sure? Maybe they didn't. I don't know. Didn't write it down.
It might have been, like, hussy or floozy.
Like, something about... She got slut-shamed, basically. That's all we need to know.
She got slut-shamed. Michael got fired. Michael and Stephanie broke up. Stephanie is kind of bitter about it, but she's still kind of her jovial self. And, alright, so Stephanie...
Yeah, but she's still, like, a crappy employee at the end.
Alright, I was gonna say, so what is Stephanie's job? She's, like... The like a server, like what is her role?
Okay, she's the housekeeper, but like basically she just does whatever Joanna doesn't want to do at the moment.
She is rude to the guests. So like there was like in the beginning of the episode,
yeah, there's like a couple, and this woman is like looking at the menu and she's like, I don't know what I want because it all looks so good. And she asks Stephanie, and Stephanie's like, well, new hair color. New lip gloss, yeah.
I believe she says less hairspray, too. And then she just, like, walks away.
Oh, yeah, less hairspray.
And then Dick's wife asks for, like, waffles. It's like your boss. Like, she's the boss.
Yeah, I have that written down, is that Stephanie forgets that Joanna is your boss.
Joanna
wants waffles or the kitchen to be open for her breakfast. You get her breakfast. Of course, then there's part of me going, why the hell doesn't Joanna just do it herself?
But then, Joanna asks why the waffles are wet, and she's like, oh, because I have to wash the coffee grinds off them?
Yeah.
Insinuating that she threw them in the trash.
Yeah. I don't understand why they kept Stephanie, because she was awful.
I mean, she's like the comic foil, I guess. I don't really know.
Yeah, I guess so. She's Joanna's foil, I think, for the most part.
And then, alright, so then Don Prince, like, also makes a remark, this relates to, like, Stephanie again, about Merchant Marines, like, being into, I guess, Joanna?
Well, like, okay, so, after the first night of Don's show, everybody, like, seems to love him insulting Dick.
So they create a segment called Pick on Dick.
So they, well, like, first the station owner's like, guess what, you're his new sidekick. And, like, makes Dick do the show with him.
Alright, so.
And they create an assignment called Put on Dick.
I thought it was Pick on Dick.
Oh, Pick on Dick, yeah, sorry.
Okay, because it definitely rhymed. So, someone in the audience
Pick on Dick! Pick on Dick!
Someone in the audience has to, like, make a joke against Dick, and then they'll give you a t-shirt, and then, like, two dinner passes to the Drum and Musket Tavern or something.
Yeah.
And
it's like, these are, like, such middle school insults.
And then there's, like, the old guy, there's, like, an old guy that will just say the same exact joke that Don Rickles just said.
Yeah. But they're like, at least he tried. And then George shows up in disguise so that he can pick on Dick.
But there's a line about, like, Merchant Marines and Joanna.
Yeah, so Don is, like, brings Joanna into it. Like, he brings in Dick's wife to make him, like, that crossed the line. Of course, then Joanna is at the inn, and Stephanie and she are getting these calls from these guys who want to know if they rent rooms by the hour because of the joke that Don made.
I believe like you only hear once of the conversations that like you hear Stephanie, she's like, "Oh, the whole fleet?" She's like, "Joanna, do you
Yeah.
rent rooms by the hour?"
And Joanna's like, oh God, really, Stephanie?
Then
Need me to deal with this?
Stephanie goes, "Oh my God, I feel so dirty. I gotta go take a shower." And she just disappears. She just leaves. Useless as always. So
Yeah, she's just the worst employee.
is Stephanie related to Joanna?
No, Stephanie is actually related to the girl who worked for them in the first season.
Okay, I knew there was like some weird tie.
Yeah. And like, oh my God, I am blanking on the character's name. Leslie, her name is Leslie. And she was like a college student at the local university, and she was trained to be a speaker for the Olympics. And this is like her job. Because it was like an easy job. It's not like a super busy inn,
I can't imagine.
you
It's
know?
probably only busy like in the summertime.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can't imagine it being like a year-round phenomenon.
Well, because Vermont has ski season though, so it should be somewhat busy during ski season.
They live near the mountains?
Yeah, they're near. They're close enough that part of the reason Leslie was there was because she could train.
Okay, so, like she was trying to be a skier.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, I
But
guess.
she, like, Stephanie was her cousin who, like, came to visit once during the first season. And then they, like, decided to write out Leslie and bring in Stephanie as the housekeeper instead.
This was definitely like part of their retooling effort.
Yeah.
All right, interesting. So should we talk about like the turn of events that happens on Vermont tonight?
Okay, well, let's see. Yeah. And they actually have another guest.
It's Frank Tuttle or Turtle, played by Ed McMahon.
It's Tuttle.
Tuttle, is it Tuttle?
Yeah.
And
Yes, it is Ed McMahon. Frank Tuttle is starring in film that is in a movie that is filming in Vermont. So that's how they were able to get him on the show.
yeah, isn't it weird that there's like all these celebrities in Vermont?
Yeah.
So you got Don Prince, you got Frank Tuttle, and Dick, who's apparently like, I guess he's famous.
He's famous in the area.
And he's probably known for being an author too.
Yeah.
So all these guys in the same room on the same show, on a late night show in Vermont, believe it or not. And they basically both start kind of like agonizing Dick.
Yeah, they're both being just like total dickweeds to Dick.
And Dick at like all right, so I guess it's like at this point it's been like weeks on the show.
Yeah, like it's been going on for a while. It's kind of like this like phenomenon in the area.
Yeah, like,
Like people love this show. They love watching Don pick on Dick. I don't understand it. I was like, this is kind of like bad.
it's a one note. Like, do you think that, like, what is, because they established that it's a 90-minute show. Like, what do you think the, like, is this the whole show, 90 minutes of them just picking on Dick?
Oh my God, that would be like, how could you sit through that?
Like, I wonder how long the show actually was on for.
Yeah.
Because like they make it seem like it's been weeks, so like Dick has been working two jobs basically at this point. He's been working his morning
Basically
show,
three, actually.
running the inn, and doing this like.
The in the his own show and this show.
And Dick finally like hits the boiling point, and I believe he calls
Like they
Don
just
Prince.
like I don't even remember what they say. He just finally snapped.
He tells on Don that he's fat and bald.
Yeah.
Like, Don Prince, like, basically insinuated that his wife was a whore, and
Yeah.
then Don calls him fat and old, and Don loses his shit, and he's like, "I can't do this anymore." And he, like, storms
He's
off
like,
set.
I'm done. And
Sorry,
walks off.
guys.
And then Frank looks at Dick and he says, "You sadistic, motherless creep."
And Dick, like, feels bad. He's like, "What? What?" He's like, "I just.
Yeah, Dick is like, I'm sorry, I snapped. And he goes to apologize. He goes to Don's dressing room, and Don's like, thank you, I can get out of this contract now.
It was all ploy. I don't, like, if he didn't want to be part of the contract, why did he agree to it?
Yeah, like, if he didn't want, well, I guess what happened was, once the show took off, there was interest in an actual, like, revival of Always whatever the freaking show is called.
It's Always Moesha.
Always Moesha.
It's Always Moesha. I
want to get out of the contract so I could go through a new way. It's Always Moesha.
I kind of want to see It's Always Moesha just to see what it was like.
I'm like curious as to like what that show was. Like, you know?
It's a strange joke that worked in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Like, they kept bringing it back.
Well, because George kept singing the theme song, like, almost every time you saw him.
I'm probably going to have to do the theme song as the opening of the episode. Just so our audience can know what it's like.
Yeah.
I believe, like, that's the end of the episode, right?
That's the end, because then Don kisses Dick, and you get the freeze frame.
And it's over.
And the credits.
Like, they're really, like, that is the whole episode. It's basically...
That's the whole episode, yeah.
There's no B storyline. There's, like, it's like a 10-second B storyline. It starts off in the inn. Then it cuts to the talk show. You get another brief scene in the inn, and then it just goes back to the talk show. And then that's it. Like, it all takes place in 21 minutes.
Yeah.
But it's an enjoyable romp. It's just mostly jokes. Like, it's just one-line jokes.
Yeah.
And I wish I could remember them, but I don't.
That's one of the things I kind of like about Newhart is it's an easy watch.
Yeah, like, other than the finale of Newhart, like, is there other notable episodes?
There is a Halloween episode where there's, like, a Halloween party. And Michael has decided to air the War of the Worlds news broadcast kind of thing on the, like, TV station.
And he causes pandemonium.
The people of this town flip out thinking they're being invaded by aliens.
Like, they don't know the War of the Worlds broadcast from, like,
yeah, they don't.
The 30s or whatever it was.
They don't know what it was. They're like, oh my god, we're being invaded by aliens! Oh no!
That reminds me, remember the movie Space Invaders? It was kind of like a play on that War of the Worlds. And it took place like in the same New Jersey town that the War of the Worlds broadcast was in.
But
on that very night they were like replaying it, like aliens actually like crash landed on the in the town. But it was like it was a comedy.
Oh my gosh.
You never seen it? It was like a kid's movie from the 90s.
I probably saw it. I just don't remember.
Okay, I think I own it on DVD. I toyed with the idea of using it as like a future podcast episode, but I figured we'd never be able to find it other than myself.
Yeah.
So we I like to have accessible things for the podcast.
Yes, I understand.
So are we missing anything for us? Is there any last minute thoughts on Peter Scolari or Julia Duffy?
There is like this cool thing. So because like I already said how Barry Kemp hired Jerry Van Dyke to be in coach, since he also created that show. Throughout the series, you will see books by Dick Loudon in the series Coach.
Oh, wow.
And also, in the finale of Coach, the characters of Larry, Daryl, and Daryl appear in Hayden's Minnesota cabin.
I did read
squatters.
That. Very interesting. Very, very interesting.
Yes, and I remember, like, I freaked when I forgot all about that when I was doing my Coach rewatch this last summer.
Oh, because you thought Coach was coming back on NBC, but then NBC was like, fuck it, and didn't bring Coach back?
Yeah. NBC, you teased me. I watched every single episode of Coach to prepare. I was excited.
I forgot how great Coach was, too. Like, it really was.
Oh, my God. Oh, God. The thing that's fascinating about Coach is you kind of see an evolution with sitcom style as you're watching it.
Go on, go on.
So, like, you have, now you're going to have, like, more of a thorough storyline throughout a season. And you're going to, like, hit certain beats. Like, in the first season, you don't really, there are certain beats that if it were written today, you would have probably hit with, in regards to the daughter's relationship with her boyfriend who becomes her husband and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
Like, just, like, relationship beats between the characters that they don't hit there, but they would today.
Okay, so it was just, like, Coach was kind of going away from the curve?
I don't know. Like, it's just, like, if you go back and watch, I think you'll see what I'm talking about. Like, just stylistically, the way the storytelling was evolved.
Like, it was
throughout the series.
It differed than other sitcoms? Is that what you're kind of alluding to?
Well, I think it started as the way sitcoms were back then. A little more like, here's an episode. Maybe we have like a story arc that goes on for like 5 episodes or something with some characters.
So they would have storylines that would span episodes?
Yeah, like the stuff that like spans, like people's relationships to span episodes are not actually like hit, like the stories are not told the way they are now.
Okay, I'll have to.
But like when you get towards the end of the series, it's more the way it would be done now.
All right, we'll have to examine that in a future episode of the podcast.
Yeah,
we'll get deep into Coach and its evolution on storytelling as a sitcom in the 90s.
Yep. We have to do a Coach episode.
Definitely, because it's available on Netflix and it's easily accessible.
Yeah, I just don't know what episode we would do because there's so many good ones.
We will definitely figure it out. We have time. So what are we doing next time?
I actually have no idea.
All right. We are doing Sybil.
Sybil, oh God, why didn't I know that? We were talking about this like yesterday.
We are staying on the CBS network.
Yes, we are.
Staying in the 90s, because I believe tonight's episode technically took place in, like, 1990. But it could have been 89. I'm not really sure.
89.
Okay. All right, so we're a few years later. We're in the 90s now. We are doing the 4th season premiere of Sybil.
Okay.
Which deals with past life regression.
Ooh, fascinating.
So I have yet to see this, so I am wondering what it's going to be like. Will it be
honestly, I don't know if I've ever seen this episode.
Will it be a fantasy episode? Who knows? We'll find out. So join us next time when we go into the world of Sybil Shepherd and Christine Baranski?
Woohoo!
And we'll see what happens. So
yeah, I have no clue.
Go to our website and tweet us, and until next time.
Bye!